Welcome to C++ for Java Programmers. I'm Professor Califf. In this video, I want to start talking about operator overloading. So we already know about overloading functions. That works the same in both C++ and Java. We can have different functions named the same thing, but with different parameter types or a different number of parameters. Operator overloading is really just a specialized form of function overloading. Now we do have some constraints. The number of operators that the operator takes is predetermined. We're not going to suddenly make the addition operator take three parameters. How parameters are passed, by value, by reference, by constant reference, may be predetermined. In some cases, at least, our overloaded operator will not work correctly unless we're passing the parameters in the expected way. We also often need to meet expectations about the return value. So when we go to overload an operator, we have to make sure that we understand the expectations for that particular operator. The name of our function is the word operator, followed by the appropriate symbol or symbols. So if we want to overload the addition operator, our function name is operator plus. If we want to override the equals operator, our function name is operator equals equals. When we're doing operator overloading in classes, we need to think about where our operator functions go. Some operators must be implemented as member functions, including the assignment operator and the index operator. On the other hand, the insertion and extraction operators can't be member functions. They must be implemented outside of the class. The reason for this is that the left-hand argument for the operator is the stream that you are writing to or reading from, and we can't modify the stream classes. Most operators can be done either as member functions or as non-member functions, and we'll look at doing one of those both ways. Okay, so let's hop over to our programming environment. And what I'm going to do is actually add some overloaded operators to our date class that we were working on in the previous video. So I'm just going to say code date star. And that will get us all of our things because they all started with date. So now we want to add the functions. What I'm going to do first is add an equals operator as a member function to our date class. So we're going to start in the .h file for the date class. And I'm just going to add at the bottom here the date equals operator. So equals returns a bool. So we'll have that. Then we need the actual name of the function. So remember that's operator equal equal. Then we need our parameters. Now we have two parameters to the equals operation, but we're writing this as a member function. So the left-hand side of the equals is going to be this. It's only the right-hand side that we're going to actually pass as a parameter. Now that parameter needs to be passed as a const reference. So it'll be const date ampersand. And then I'm going to just call it RHS. You'll see that quite a bit, RHS standing for right-hand side. And we'll just declare this here and write the actual code over in the .cpp file. So, as we actually do the implementation, we have bool, then this is a member function, so we're going to have date colon colon, and then our name of the function, operator equal equal, and then our parameters, just the same as they were in the .h file, or it was in the .h file. Then to compare these things, I'm just going to say return and check whether all the different elements are equal. So that will be this arrow year equals RHS dot year. So notice this is a pointer, so we need the arrow operator, but RHS is a reference, so we use the dot operator. and this dot, this arrow, month equals rhs.month, and this arrow, day equals rhs.day. Now, one other thing I want to note while we're here is sometimes people get confused and will wonder why we can actually access the year, the month, or sorry, the year, the month, and the day of right-hand side, because we're not in that object. But when we talk about things being private, they are only private to the class. They are not private to any individual object. So if I'm in any individual method, even a class method, and I have access to an object, I can get at the private data and methods of that object. So we're just fine here. Okay, now we want to actually use this. So I'm going to say cout default date equals a dereference of school start. And that should of course be false. And then let's actually set up another date. Just gonna call it other date and give it the parameters 8/17 and 2020 so that we can compare and get a true value from our equals. So default date equals, or sorry, other date equals star school start. Okay, so the first of those should be false. The second one should be true. Let's go make sure I haven't made any compile time errors or anything. So G++. And I'm going to note here, I can use wildcards to get the various file names for the files I want to compile. So since both my date.cpp and my dateexperiments.cpp start with date and nothing else in this directory does, I can just say G++ date star.cpp, saving myself the trouble of typing out date.cpp and dateexperiments.cpp. So then we'll run that, and we're going to see that, in fact, the first of our two prints produced a zero, which is false, and that was expected. And then the second one produced a one, which is what we wanted there. So that's what it looks like to overload an operator as a member function. Now I'm going to show you overloading it as a non-member function. We're going to actually look at doing the insertion operator, which is our output operator. And there, remember, we can't do a member function because the first parameter is a stream. So it would be that class that we could potentially put it in. We can't put it in our class because we're the second parameter. So even though this is not a member of the function, I'm still going to put it in my date.h and date.cpp because it is closely related to the date. I'm only going to use it if I'm using the date class. So we're going to put the prototype for it in date.h and the actual implementation in date.cpp, just like we do for member functions. So what this one looks like, it turns out that the insertion operator and also the extraction operator, so both of those operators, return a reference to the stream. And that's what enables us to go from one to another, because each of them is returning the reference to the stream that we were using. And so then it's available to be the left-hand side for the next one. Then of course we have operator. And in this case, we're doing the insertion operator, which is two less than signs. Then this isn't a member function. We have two parameters. We need to actually specify both of them in the parameter list. So the first of those will be the O string. And since I'm not, don't have using namespace standard here, I am going to need the std colon colon in front of my O string references. Okay, so the O string is not const. The O string can't be constant because we're modifying it. We're writing something out to it, so it's changing. So that's a mistake that sometimes gets made. And I'm going to just call this outstream. Then the date we want to print actually will be a const date reference. And I'm going to call that date to print. So now let's copy this and bring it back over to be our header for our function in date.cpp. So how are we going to do this? Well, I'm going to kind of cheat because I already have a function that's part of the class and has access to everything that produces the date in a format that makes a lot of sense. So what I'm going to do is to say outstream. Well, actually, I got to return because I got to return the stream itself. And I'm just going to say outstream use the insertion operator on get short date. Only I've got to specify what date I want to do that with. So date to print dot get short date. Notice that I need the parentheses here because if I don't have them, this isn't going to compile properly. Okay, now we want to actually use date experiments. So let's just come in here and change our prints so that instead of calling getShortDate, they just pass in the object. Now, of course, since I want the object, not a pointer to the object, I do need to dereference that school start. Not sure if I need to put that in parentheses. We will check. Okay, we have everything there. We did not save it here. I bet we didn't save it there. That was our problem. Okay, and you can see that then that prints exactly the same as if we had printed the date directly, but now we're just printing the object. So what I'd like to talk to you next about is how we're actually going to handle things if we're doing an operator overload as a non-member function, but it needs to have access to private variables. Now we've actually dealt with that one of the ways we could deal with that. So with the insertion operator, we didn't actually do much except call a function that gave us the data that we wanted. We didn't have to actually go deal with the member variables directly. We did it through this existing function. And that is one of the common ways to handle this situation. But if we think about changing the equals operator so that instead of being a member of the class, we made it a non-member function, we would have to either do what we did basically for the insertion operator, which would be to write a method that we could then call to check to see if things were equal. Or we need to somehow provide access to the instance variables so that the equals operator can do its work. So one way to do that is something called friends. And this basically is a way to break the rules when it comes to private data and methods, and actually protected data and methods. Friends can be methods, or they can be other classes. Opinions vary quite a bit regarding them. Many consider the whole concept to be a horrible thing because it breaks encapsulation. Others simply consider it useful and practical. You can usually avoid using friends, but it can cause extra function calls, as we see with our insertion operator. Though we could also consider that to simply be good code reuse, as long as we actually want that function somewhere else. Regardless, friends exist, so I'm going to show you how to use them. Note that the class is going to say who its friends are. nobody else can make a class except a friend. So this is somewhat of an advantage as we compare it to, say, Java packages, where I can come along and say, oh, I'm a member of that package. Didn't you know that? Only the class can decide that another class or a method is its friend. We declare the function in the class, or the class in the class. So the new friend class we declare in the existing class using the friend keyword. We can even fully define the function in the class as a friend, but it won't be part of the class. Now with classes, we just declare it. Friends can access what is private or what is protected. So let's actually take a look at what this looks like by rewriting equals so that it's a friend of the class instead of being a member function. So let's pull this back up, get our code over here. And first we're going to start in the .h file. So the biggest thing we're going to do in the .h file is to just come in here and in front of our declaration, we're going to say, this is my friend. Now we need to make one more change, because as soon as we made this a non-member function, we don't have the calling object. So we currently only have one parameter instead of the two we need. So we need to add the parameter for the left-hand side. That will also be a const date reference. And I'm just going to call that LHS for left-hand side. And that's all we need to do in the .h file to make this a friend. Then I'm going to come over to the .cpp file. Need to make a few changes here. First one is simply removing the date colon colon from the header, because this is no longer a member of date. So we don't have that date colon colon there. Then of course I need to add my left-hand side parameter. And then I need to modify these, this arrows to be LHS dots, because now I'm not looking at this, I'm looking at the object called left-hand side and the dot, because it's a reference, not a pointer. And change this one to LHS dot. And so now in the program itself, we have nothing to change, because nothing has changed about how we're going to use the function. The only thing that changed is how we implemented this operator. So I think we've saved everything. Let's come back and compile and run. And you can see that we get the same results with the non-member function as we got with the member function. Thanks for watching. In the next video, we'll make use of our operator overloading as we look at creating C++ classes that correctly manage dynamically allocated memory.